Afternoon, gang. It's Saturday the 18th of March 2017. Welcome along to today's United Kingdom talk. Last week, I think I got the date wrong twice. Once I said it was the wrong year, and I think it was yesterday or something, I said it was the wrong, I said it was April. I mean, I seem to be going ahead of myself or backwards in time. Perhaps I am the human time machine. That might be what it is. Look, I got a gift last night. Ray Reynolds, famous for the George Formby Society. He was a DJ once, you know. Bought me this wonderful light blue t-shirt. It goes with the background, actually. Look at this. If I can't wear it in here, Ray, because I'll disappear into the background. You'll see why. Look at this. Isn't that lovely? Look at that. A BBC television colour t-shirt. Oh, yeah, baby. Thank you, Ray Reynolds, for this. I know you'll be watching the show at some point today. Thank you very much to Ray Reynolds for my BBC television. Look, it's the same as the background there. Isn't that clever? I love it. Thank you very much, Ray. Let's say hello to the early birds today. Adam's with us this morning. Good morning, Adam. Ray Reynolds. Oh, Ray's with us this morning. Sorry, Ray, I didn't even know you were there. Look at that. The opening part of the show today was your new T-shirt that you gave to me. I mean, thank you so much. Thank you, dear. Ray Reynolds says, good morning from Ray and friends of the George Formby Society. Sarita says, good morning, Chris. The countdown music is very relaxing. How is Katie the cat? She's not doing too badly, actually. She's spending a lot of time walking around in circles, usually. But she does stop and she likes to be picked up and cuddled. Sometimes I have to force cuddle her. Do you know what that means with a cat? When it's force cuddled, it doesn't really want to be cuddled. I mean, you know. You do know when a cat wants to be cuddled and when it doesn't want to be cuddled. Generally, they don't. My mate's cats, they hate it. They absolutely hate being picked up and cuddled. So you have to force cuddle them. I don't think that's a cruel thing. Just for a few seconds. Just for a few seconds to rub that fur against your face. Oh, isn't it lovely? She's all right, Katie. Mary's with us this morning. Morning, Mary, who had a wonderful time last night, didn't you? I could see you had a nice time last night. Sarita says, can anyone explain why the background has changed? You mean that behind me now? Because it was time for a change. It usually gets changed once a year. We've had all different backgrounds, actually. We've had purple. I think we've had dark blue. We had black. We had the little Union Jack ones. And now we've got light blue. So it changes, generally changes once a year, Sarita. All right, darling. Hello to Paul Dale, who says, the cat chooses you. Well, that's right, Paul. Cats choose people. They choose people. When I go downstairs, she might have been making a loud noise. I think it's a cry out that she's lonely. I do think that. And you go in and she immediately calms down. And actually, when I go in the kitchen, if she's been walking around, she starts walking around faster in her little circle, almost as if she's excited to see me. And I do pick her up. Actually, she loves the cuddles, this my cat. You don't have to force cuddle my cat. That's true, that is. Ronnie's, you'd have to force cuddle them and they can't wait to get down. Each cat has got its own personality, isn't it? Just like humans and dogs as well. They've all got their own personality. Hello to Ben, who says, yes, that's quite right. Ben says the old background was causing problems with our brand new camera that is in front of us this morning. There's another new one out now. Oh, Logitech have bought a brand new camera out. I was telling you yesterday, I think it was, or the day before, where you can actually change the backgrounds, but 200 quid, a little bit dear. Little bit dear. We've just bought this one, so let's get some use out of this one first. There's one behind me as well. If you've not been with the show for a while, look at this. We've got one behind us over there as well now, so you can see what's going in front of me, you see. Yeah, it might be a good idea to make sure I haven't got anything dodgy on my screen before I turn the camera around like that, I reckon. All right, so there's one behind me as well. Sarita loves the painting. Thank you, Sarita. I've actually got a few different paintings, so you'll see them change now and again. That's... it's like a little fishing town with all the sea and all that. Beautiful, isn't it? Beautiful. Paul says, Doctor Who. What about Doctor Who? I am a Time... Yes, I'm a Time Lord. I can't decide if it's 2017, 2016, March or April. I just flick between two time zones easily. Talking of Doctor Who, that's coming back next month. Now, I think it was April the 15th, possibly. 15th, maybe? Hang on, I'll look it up for you. Let me look it up for you. One moment, please. Return of Doctor Who. And this is, of course, Peter Capaldi's last Doctor Who, which I think is a shame. The money is on the bloke that does the police series on an island. Oh, Lord, what is that called now? Is it Paradise Island? Something like that. He's a thin blonde bloke. And I believe the money is on him. Let me see if I can find out the... it just says... No, it doesn't say... Hang on, let's try the Wikipedia thing. No, it doesn't say... Oh, here we go. 15th of April. It's coming back on Saturday. I think that's got to be a Saturday night. Saturday the 15th of April. And it'll be 12 episodes. About blooming time, too. They seem to get shorter and shorter. So we got 12 episodes of the next series, OK? After it began filming in June last year. The series is being led by head writer and producer Stephen Moffat, who's very good at what he does. But I can't follow a lot of his work, I'm afraid. I think he made Doctor Who really complicated, and there were so many times I've been watching it and I'm not sure how it gets from one scene to the other. Do you know what I mean? Difficult to follow. I don't rate his writing for Doctor Who. That doesn't mean he's rubbish, just not for me. I just couldn't follow it. It'd become too complicated. All right, it'd be the third and final series overseen by Stephen Moffat, and then they've got a new bloke going in. Now, let me find out who they reckon is going to be the new Doctor Who. Bets for new Doctor Who. Let's have a look. The latest odds. Oh, okay. It's in the Sun, is it? That's a Tilda. No, that's not who I thought it was. There he is. Hang on a minute. What's he in? Chris Marshall. I believe Chris Marshall. That's who they think it's going to be. Indeed, if you was to put a bet on now, it's evens. So I think, I'm not a betting person, but I think if you put a pound on, you get a pound back. So what's the point of doing that, eh? You run the risk of losing your pound or getting it back. I wouldn't bother putting it on. That's mad, isn't it? Anyway, it says the highest odds are currently on Chris Marshall as to be tipped as the next Doctor. Death in Paradise, that's it. It's an excellent series. An excellent series. If you're outside the UK, you may not have seen Death in Paradise, but it's filmed on this island, like in the Caribbean. It could be Martinique. Can't remember the name of the island now. Anyway, it's filmed on this island in the Caribbean. And basically, it's about how they catch murderers. And I think they're all murders, actually, aren't they? They're all murders. People die on the island, and he goes and helps, that he's like in charge of the police in the little sort of sphere that he works in. And he lives on the island, and it's an excellent program, and he's a great actor. He's a really good actor. So I hope that he gets it. It says the actor left death. Oh, he's left it. Okay, so he's not going to be in Death in Paradise anymore. All right, so it's still on at the moment, so I'm still watching it. The actor left Death in Paradise earlier this year to spend more time with his family, Sunbet spokesman Tim Reynolds says. To our disgust, we've seen continued money for Chris Marshall to be the next Doctor Who and regret to announce he is now our 3-1 favourite. Oh, he'd be good. I think he'd be good. So you can't have Doctor Who... you can't have him bland and dull. He's got to have a lot of character. He must have a lot of character. Not like these presenters on independent local radio. Bland and dull. That's why I don't listen to them. Heart FM. Better music mix and all that business. No. Not bland. It's got to be a person with massive character. And he would have that. I honestly think he would have that. This bloke in the Sun goes on to say, quite why that boring bloke from the BT adverts could be in line for one of the most iconic lead roles in British television history, we can't work out, but our punters seem to fancy him, as indeed I do. So he's the odds-on favourite. Chris Marshall, I hope he gets the job. We could, of course, have a woman playing Doctor Who. We don't know. I don't have a problem with that. What I do have a problem is where people make such a big thing of it. Why can't we have a woman Doctor Who? You know, Why can't we have a black Doctor Who? It doesn't matter what colour or what sex they are. We just want another Doctor Who. But what I get a bit upset when the papers start blowing that out of all. Oh, we should have a woman Doctor Who. Well, yeah, OK, if that's what you think. Yeah, but why go on and on about it? It's like the whole black president and female prime minister. No, to me, like you see, I don't see a female prime minister. I don't see a male prime minister. I see a prime minister. Why go on about what sex or what blooming colour they are all the time? Stupid. They're also saying possibly Tilda Swinton. She's apparently a lady in the running. I don't know much about her. I'm looking at her photo now. Beautiful red lipstick. She looks like a Doctor Who. And she could be a Doctor Who. I tell you what I'd like to see if it's a funny Doctor Who, Dawn French. Absolutely. Dawn French would be an excellent Doctor Who. That would really bring a lot of humour into it. What do you reckon? Here's a question for you then. On this morning's show, boys and girls, do you know, it's funny. I don't prepare this. Honestly, I sit here. When I say I don't prepare this, look, this is what I've got written down. This is my preparation today, okay? This is what I've done in the last half an hour while I've been preparing to do the show. And I've got all these as well, okay? Just in case I run out of stuff to say. And all this isn't just a random load of paper. What I've done is gone through a couple of newspapers and pulled out stories that I think would be interesting. And I'm often looking at it and I'm thinking to myself, Doctor Who wasn't part of that this morning. Doctor Who has not been part of the preparation. I don't know. Don't even know how that's come up. Was it some comments? Was it a comment someone made? Was it actually a comment someone just made or something like that that brought me onto Doctor Who? Anyway, so I look through the papers and I think to myself, now, what could I suggest for people to ring in about? Because, you know, if you've got nothing, if you don't suggest something for people to talk about, what is the point of ringing in? Well, mind you, some of them do it, don't they? You know, who is it usually? Oh, Ross Patzelt. He usually rings up. Yeah, I thought I'd ring in the show. OK, Ross, what you got to say? Well, I don't know. What are you talking about? Well, haven't you been listening? No, I just thought I'd ring in. And it's a bit like that, Ross. Ross, who incidentally managed to ask Tony Blackburn to give me a call the other day. And he did. I spoke to Tony Blackburn the other day, which was just marvellous. It really was. You didn't see that. It was a private call after the show. But I'm just in awe of having received and so many nice comments from Tony Blackburn the other day. Anyway, back to this. Tilda Swinton. Now, Tilda is being strongly tipped to become, here we go, the first ever female Doctor Who. Why make such a thing of it? Whether it's female, black, white, gay, straight, don't make any difference. It's just another Doctor Who. But they do. It goes on. The British Oscar-winning actress, who has already been tipped for the role by previous Time Lord Paul McGann, I mean, you could hardly say Paul McGann was a Doctor Who. He was only in one film. How does that make him a Doctor Who? He wasn't a real Doctor Who, was he? He was just an actor playing Doctor Who. Doctor Who, of course he exists, dear. It's like, honestly, what is wrong with you people this morning? Doctor Who exists, it's a real person, dear. Unless it's Paul McGann, who was just acting Doctor Who. They only wanted him for the one film. I don't actually know why he only did one film. It was all right, you know. But that Doctor Who film that they made a while ago with Paul McGann, excellent actor and all that, but it was a bit American car crash, wasn't it? You know, we had the cars chasing each other, and I don't think there were any monsters in it, were there, if I remember rightly? You can't have Doctor Who without monsters. In the new series, there's going to be some monsters called the Monks, M-O-N-K-S, which I think, if I read I read about it yesterday, is in programmes 7 and 8 or 8 and 9, one of those two. They're supposed to be really scary. New monsters coming in Doctor Who. It says the British Oscar-winning actress has already been tipped for a role by previous Time Lord Paul McGann, is now the hot favourite to take over from Capaldi. Oh, didn't they just say that Chris Marshall was? They're like contradicting themselves here. We got Anthony Head. Anthony Head is a newcomer in the odds who will be the next Doctor. The British actor rose to fame after being featured in Nescafe Blood Goldblend advert. Now, I'm looking at him. He doesn't look like a Doctor Who to me, Anthony Head. He's not, you know, great actor. I don't know. I can't see him being Doctor Who. Richard Ayoade. Oh, I can't bear him. He's in that Gadget programme, isn't it? Oh, it's just, he's just annoying. Do you know what I mean, Richard? Richard became a household name for his BAFTA-winning role as Morris Moss in The It Crowd. I don't know what that is. He turned his hand behind the camera and directed Submarine and Double, which starred Jesse Eisenberg. The London-born star, whose background is Nigerian, would be the first actor of colour. Here we go again. You know, why do you need to mention his blooming colour? Does it make any difference? He's just another Doctor Who person. I don't know why they're obsessed with sex and colour all the time. Anyway, Richard Ayoade. I can't remember him as an actor. I don't think I've seen him as an actor. I've seen him presenting the gadget show, some gadget programme that he did. And what he did was get all these new gadgets in and try them out for us, which was mildly entertaining. But I just found him annoying. Probably a few people find me annoying in the world, although I find it difficult to believe. We've got another lady here, Olivia Coleman. No, she don't look like a Doctor Who. No, she's she was in Broadchurch. We'll see which I didn't watch. Richard Madden, a bit too pretty. Mind you, we've had pretty boys doing it, haven't we? We had that Matt Smith. He was a pretty boy. Pretty boys doing Doctor Who don't really do it for me. You're probably surprised to hear that. I had my eyes all over someone in the Waitrose Cafe earlier today, I must tell you. No, I didn't take a secret picture and send it to people. No, no, not Richard Madden. And there's a few other people there. Ben Whishaw. Now, he's young and pretty. Yeah, he looks like a Doctor Who. Oh, yeah, and here we go again. Ben Whishaw would be the first openly gay actor. It doesn't make any difference. Why do they go on about these things? Anyway, yeah, I could see him as a Doctor Who. He's got, like, loads of hair and... Yeah, that could... But it's only 20 to 1. 20 to 1 on that one. James Norton. Who else we got? Rhys Shearsmith and people like that. So here's my question to you on the show today, boys and girls. Lines are now open. Look at that. The phone line has opened. Who do you think would make a good next Doctor Who? Any ideas at all? Who would perhaps you like to see being the next Doctor Who? Call in now and let me know, boys and girls. It's 020-8144-3477. My call-in number, 020-8144-3477. Who would you like to be the next Doctor Who? We've got Blakey calling in from Peckham. Good afternoon, Blakey. How are you, sir?
Oh, yeah. Well, let me just turn you off because we've got two voices going on there. That's it.
Yeah, yeah.
There's only one Chris Reardon, not two.
There's only one me, Blakey, and there's only one you as well, sir, I have to say.
I know. Amazingly, I can't believe there's only one of me. If there were more of me around, this world would be a lot of better place.
Well,
would
no,
make a great Doctor Who?
No, knowing how you've been with the ladies, I'm surprised there is only one of you.
No, I'm surprised there ain't I'm not surprised because I put two condoms on when I go.
Oh, okay. Stop that now. There must be a little Blakey on somewhere.
I've got about three or four on.
There must be a little Blakey around somewhere, Blakey, that you don't know about.
Yeah, there might be a little gay Blakey running around somewhere being really gay, you know.
So tell us, Doctor Who, who would you like to see as Doctor Who?
I reckon that Chris Reardon will make a great Doctor Who.
Me?
Because you've got a good sense of humour. Got a good sense of humour. And he's sort of like a bit like Darth Vader. I remember you gave me that advice a few years ago when you first met me.
What was that?
At Belushi's. And you said to me, you said to me while you was like setting up the karaoke, I said, what do you do for a living? Nothing much, I just do karaoke. And then you said to me those immortal words that kind of like affect me now. You said, oh, you're not a doer. And I took a while, what do you mean not a doer? Oh, I'm not a doer. No, I'm not. Now I'm a doer. I actually got to go and ask her out.
You're a doer now.
Like Dino said, if you don't ask, you don't get.
That's right.
So, like, don't worry about rejection. It doesn't exist.
That's right. That's right.
But once you get over that, you can, yes, you can chat that attractive woman up. She's too attractive to talk to. Why? Why does every woman you have to chat to have to be ugly, Blakey? Ain't you got enough confidence? And now I can.
But I've always said to you, you're not ugly, mate. You're very good looking.
I'm ugly.
You know, if you was on my bus, I would jump straight at the opportunity of a little date with you, Blakey.
I wouldn't turn you down because it would be rude.
Eh?
I wouldn't turn you down because it would be rude. What's that other karaoke singer? He used to really fancy me that time. It was a bit wet. I can't remember his name though.
Fancy me or you?
Good idea to like name drop on.
No, probably not. Because they might not be out. You know, they might be secretly gay.
No,
you never know that.
Out. It was the first time I had a full gay snog in Belushi's, and everyone saw me.
Did you? I never saw that.
Oh my god!
I never saw that.
Had a nightmare about this, about a bloke kissing me and everyone seeing. And so he was doing it. He was singing cabaret. He was playing around with a chair like he's on Flash Dance or something, and he was really attracted to me.
Who was that then? You say he is gay, is he?
Yeah, he's gay. I was happily. Simon Happily. Was it Simon Happily?
Oh, did he? Well, that wouldn't have been at one of my do's. He's never been to one of mine.
Yeah, he's a bit wet. Has he ever tried it on with you?
No, not me, no.
What about that young stud in your profile picture? Is that your new boyfriend?
No. That's a customer. That's a customer. And sometimes they like a little photo taken with the huge star that I am. I allow it, you know.
I can tell that you were the one who's more chuffed about that photo. More you, Clow. You're looking at this. I think
what happens is that I like to take the photo of me and then they show it to all her friends. Look who I got off with last night. I think it's like, you know, a little badge,
terrible.
You know, like a badge that they like to wear.
I just introduced your voice to my loudspeaker, to my phone. Basically, I'm doing the first ever two-way conversation, United Kingdom talk, and it's also featuring Blakey Telly. So basically, I'm filming myself on my mobile phone, speaking to you on my house phone. And, like, it's amazing. It's going to be like a cross.
You're getting very, very technical, Blakey.
I might call you when you least expect it. You could be on the loo. You could be shagging someone. You could be having your live talk. It's going to be rock and roll.
Do you ever do the live Facebook things, Blakey? Do you do those?
I don't know how to do it.
What phone have you got?
I have to wait 2 hours for a video to download because I need to upgrade my PC.
What telephone have you got?
I've got a great telephone.
Well, you can do it on there, can't you? You can do it on there, live Facebook.
Well, see these phone calls that I'm phoning. It's all free because my mum done this special booster thing you got on your phone, and where you can speak for 59 minutes, then you hang up for 2 minutes, then phone again.
All right.
That's great. One time I talked for so long, I went over 1 minute and one minute. I went over 1 hour and 1 minute, and I was so sweating like a pig. I was like, because I'm not very good at asserting myself, I didn't know how to, like, get rid of the person on the phone call. So I finally done it. I thought, oh, God. Right, please, can I just... I just want to go to the toilet. I'll call you back in a couple of minutes.
No, you go to the toilet. We've had our conversation. You're suggesting me. So thank you very much for that, Blakey.
Thank you, mate. God bless you.
Have a lovely day. Cheerio. He's fantastic. Mad as a hatter, the same as myself, and fantastic. So Blakey is suggesting me as the next Doctor Who. Unfortunately, I'm not an actor. I don't have an equity card or anything like that. So presumably, I wouldn't be able to get on for that job. I don't know. Who do you think should be the next Doctor Who? Call in and let me know. 020-8144-3477 is the phone in number. Or if you've got Skype, you can Skype in, boys and girls. My Skype in is all one word, United Kingdom Talk. Who do you want to be the next Doctor Who? Skype in, United Kingdom Talk, or call in. 020-8144-3477. As always, I'll let you know, it's a local London number, okay? You won't be charged any extra for the call other than it's a local call. And generally, if you call in from a mobile phone, it's like part of your package anyway. So 020-8144-3477. Messages coming in. Oh, let's just go to Vectis on the Isle of Wight before I go to your messages there. Good afternoon, Vectis on the Isle of Wight. How are you on Isley Widgets?
Good afternoon, Chris. I'm fine.
Oh, what time?
Can
you just give me your show times? Because I need to make sure that I don't go on air at the same time as you, because we lose all of our millions of tens of thousands of listeners that we've got on the Isle of Wight. So when are you on, Vectis?
I'm not on this week, but I'm normally on between 1 and 4 on a Sunday.
1 to 4 on Sundays.
And I was actually stood in for the rock show presenter last night between 7 and 11, which is quite funny, really, for what I know about rock music. But hey,
I was going to say that. There was who was it now? Steve Allen. I think Steve Allen on LBC years ago is not into sport, but had to present a sports programme. He managed to get through it. I mean, if you asked me to do a sport, I wouldn't have a clue what I was doing. I'm not interested in sport at all. Are you?
No. I mean, quite into Formula One and motorsport. We have a speedway team on the island, which I'm quite proud of. It's quite good for the old Italy widget to actually have a professional motorsport team. I'm not really into football and stuff like that.
Is there a track on the Isle of Wight then that they can practice on?
Yes, I have. It's either one of two, or I've got a feeling it's the biggest speedway track in the whole of the Great Britain, I'll have you know.
Well, I didn't know that. Whereabouts is that then?
It's at Smallbrook. It's literally just outside of Ryde, sort of around the sort of Tesco's area of the outskirts of Ryde. It used to be an athletics track, which I believe is what the speedway track is, actually. It's on that very same site. But we had speedway for about 10 years, and then it went away. And now there's a very committed team that got it back last year, and it was absolutely phenomenal success last year, because it's been made into a really family night out. Even if you're not into big noisy motorbikes, there's stuff for kids to do on push bikes, and there's sweet stalls, and they make a big effort with the catering there. It's not just a traditional greasy burger, which of course I would never touch myself, but they do all sorts of healthy options there.
You're not eating those dead animal rolls and chips still, are you?
I have, for reasons which I won't go into, but I am a bit under doctor's orders. I'm actually losing weight. So if you do come down in June or September, you won't recognise me. You'll walk straight past.
Oh.
I've lost a fair bit of weight already.
I might have done that anyway.
I can get into boxers that used to be tight, so they're not tight anymore.
How much have you lost?
I don't know. I haven't weighed myself yet, actually. But you can just tell, can't you? Because you know from the... from the sort of clothes you used to wear. But the thing is, Chris, I'm trying not to be on a diet, because the trouble is with being a diet and really cutting down on what you eat and what have you, is that sooner or later you're going to go off the diet, and the probability is you'll put the weight back on. So try to be sensible and just, make a lifestyle change, really. It sounds very high and mighty, doesn't it?
That's exactly what it is, a lifestyle change. Tell me, have you ever gone in one of the... what are they called? They're not power cars. What are they called? Race cars. Have you ever gone on a race car experience where you can actually drive one?
No, I haven't. I'd quite fancy. Funny enough, where I do it for a living, quite fancy truck racing. Do that down. They still have a British series. Yeah. There's only about 5 or 6 meetings throughout the year.
Right.
But I quite fancy that. That sounds quite good fun. It's sort of like the front half of sort of Arctic, that deliver to Aldi, or in your case, of course, Waitrose.
Yes.
It's the front half of those, obviously, without the trailers. And that's,
I used to watch
that about 30 years ago at Brands Hatch.
I've seen that, yeah.
Those days, it used to be sort of Fred Bloggs haulage would turn up into the car park at Brands Hatch with about 20 tonne of potatoes on the back. Drop the trailer and then have a good weekend's racing, but thinking, I best be careful, because Fred Bloggs Superstores wants that load of potatoes Monday morning, so they didn't want to ding the tractor unit in case they couldn't carry on their jobs. But of course, like with everything, like with football and snooker and football, Formula One's always been the same.
Yeah.
The manufacturers got into a big way, so now the trucks that you actually see on the track bear very, very little recognition to... What's on the road. They might look like it, but the mechanicals underneath are nothing.
Oh, like really?
It took a bit of the grassroots away from it, you know what I mean?
I thought it was just, when you see those trucks racing, just the front bits, I thought they just disengaged the back part from it, and that's what it was. So they actually...
No, they used to. It's not like that now.
So they actually change what's underneath now, do they?
Yeah, I think so. And just like overboost all the sort of like engine and what have you. But I guess there's still bits and pieces of it that filter down to road going trucks, you know. But I haven't been for ages, but I must do. Callum would like that. He's looking to get into HGV maintenance and what have you.
So is that what he wants to do, your boy?
Yeah, well, he's doing a light vehicle course at the moment, sort of repair course. But yep. I'm not sure whether it's a nationwide thing, but especially on the island, there's a desperate shortage of, like, heavy HGV mechanics.
Yeah.
It seems to be that people are retiring out of the industry and there's no young people to get it. It's not a badly paid job either. So, yeah, hopefully I've got a few things in the fire. I've got a few contacts. So hopefully it will come good. But anyway, you're talking about Doctor Who. You should be the next Doctor Who.
Yes, please, yes.
What about Robert Carlyle? Do you know who he is?
No, I don't.
The guy who used to play Hamish Macbeth on the telly.
Robert Carlyle. Let me have a look. Robert.
Probably recognises. He's quite a well-known actor.
Robert Carlyle. Is with a Y, is it his name? Scottish actor.
That's right, yeah. Do you remember that TV series from ages ago?
No, I don't.
Hamish Macbeth.
Hang on.
It was about a copper on a Scottish island or in Scotland.
Yes, I remember that.
He seemed to play quite a quirky, eccentric character. I reckon he'd be quite funny. I reckon he'd be quite good. I don't know what he's done recently. Not a lot, I don't think.
I don't know enough about him to say whether or not I think he'd make a good Doctor Who, to be honest. I'm trying to think of that. Was it on the Isle of Skye?
Yeah, I think so.
It was
like
on
that.
The Isle of Skye. He wasn't the lead character, though, was he? Or was he?
Yeah, because that's who Hamish Macbeth was. He was the local light copper, so the series was sort of named after him. You know, obviously after the character, not him. But,
No, I can't say. I don't know enough about him, really. But that's who you would make the best Doctor Who, yeah?
Yeah, I think so. I think you need someone a bit eccentric, don't you? So you want someone
absolutely,
with a bit of character, don't you?
Oh, you can't have anyone dull. Dull and bland. That's what happens if you go to the Radio Academy. You come out dull and bland.
You know, I've got to be very careful where I'm connected with a certain radio station, but we're going FM in the summer.
Yes.
I must admit, I've got to be a bit careful. I'll whisper a bit so no one hears.
Yeah, don't tell anyone. Just a minute. There's someone outside the door.
Right.
It's okay. They're not listening. Carry on.
Can you turn a tap on or something? So they can't
I should turn a tap on. I'll make a noise in it.
Right.
Go on, tell me now.
I feel a bit of this commercial radio nonsense happening at the station that I work at.
Oh, no.
All this thing about you have to mention what the radio station is and every link or whatever, and it's making me cringe. I sent an email to the program director and got a bit of a... it was all right. It was 90% of it was all right, but I got the sort of impression that that's the way we're going, and if you don't like it, it's time to leave, you know. It wasn't that bad. Other than that, it was an email saying you are valued and, you know, what have you. But I don't know. It's just I don't get this... I don't get this thing that everything has to be so bland and commercial, and that makes it popular. But then I guess the old listening figures don't lie, do they? These big regional commercial stations get a lot of listeners, but is that just
because
sort of background music in shops?
You know what I've heard before from people, and I go along this: just because a lot of people like it doesn't mean it's good.
No. Because, I mean, it's like what I do, my show. If I bore people silly, new people that I meet, say, I'm on the radio, and say, oh, what do you do and what sort of music do you play? I said, well, the music's always chosen for me. Not that you're not allowed to change it within reason. It's not that bad. But my show's sort of a bit like, well, it's exactly like what you do, really, but just shorter segments, because obviously I've got ads to play and news and weather to get to and what have you. So I do the same as you, but I only have to do it once a week.
To be honest... If that's the only thing that they come out with, you've got away lightly. I mean, I suppose every 5 minutes I could say you're watching United Kingdom talk, but it's a bit different with this, you know, because all this online stuff, like my show, online radio shows. So you see, with that, you have chosen to watch this, yeah?
Yeah.
With online radio stations, generally, you have chosen to listen to it. Whereas
That's
on
right.
FM radio, It's just on in the background, right?
Mm.
So while I'm doing this, it's not necessary to say you're watching United Kingdom. It comes up at the top of the damn thing when you switch it on. You know, with the radio station on in the background, you don't know what you're listening to. You know, someone could come in the room and not know that they're listening to Heart FM. That's why they keep saying it. So if that's the only thing that changes, then I could do that. I could do that. But there are some states, I think it's Heart, actually, where they want you to say the station name at the beginning, then you talk, and then again at the end. I mean, how many times? There's a lot of people totally obsessed by branding. They are so obsessed with branding. Now, I was listening, again, going back to our leader, Tony Blackburn, yesterday. He didn't say listening
to... Oh, you name-dropper, stop it.
He didn't keep saying BBC Radio Berkshire every 2 minutes. Now and again, he said it. And for me, that's enough. Mm. You don't need to keep saying it. But some of these people are so obsessed with branding all the time. And they've put branding above the actual personalities that people like are listening to you at the moment, you see. Of course, I don't need to tell you that if it does get a bit too much and it does go too far down that road and you don't want to do it anymore, there's a million online radio stations now where you could get on. Probably the best one would be Reach. Have you heard of Reach FM?
I haven't, actually. No.
Okay. Reach Radio. I presume you've got a little bit of gear in your house, have you? Not as in drugs. No, a little bit of equipment. If you've got a mixer, a computer, some music on your computer and a microphone, you can just do it all online. And being radio, it's a lot simpler than what I'm doing. You know, no pictures.
Yeah. I hope it doesn't come to that, because I believe in what we're doing. But I think it's just... I think the moment you have to start, there's a pressure on you to make money, because obviously the difference between
but you're not allowed to
on the internet,
you're not
and then
allowed
getting
to
a community FM license, you've then got to pay for that every year.
Yes.
You've got to pay for the transmit, you've got to pay for rental for that. And I just think it's a bit of a show. I think the thing is, I think commercial mush, it's safe, isn't it?
Yeah.
And if you go down the route of what I'd like to think I am, I don't know, my listeners might totally disagree, but if you go down the line of personality-led radio, well, then some people aren't going to like you, are you? That's life, because your show's based on your personality, isn't it?
I've heard your show several times. Your show comes across as a very warm, family, let's all get together type show. That's how your show comes across. If I listen to Radio 1... they're just shouting at me. They're not having a conversation.
With these modern stations that play sort of like all this new music, they're always shouting to you all the time. They talk really quickly.
That's right.
As well, I don't get it.
That's right, yeah. They're just shouting at me. Whereas you, it's like, come round and let's have a little bit of a chat. And it's very warm and friendly. And I think sometimes with the commercial radio, it's been bashed out of people. And I said so many times, you know, there's many young people out there with huge amounts of talent. They want to go into radio. They get in there and all the talent is bashed out of them.
It's sterile, isn't it?
And then it becomes all bland and boring. And that's why I don't I don't listen to any of it. I don't listen to any music radio at all. Do you know that?
Why are these radio stations so frightening, Chris, of sort of personality-led radio?
I don't know.
It's like the Emperor's New Clothes, isn't it? As if someone's come up with this idea of, no, you can't have any personality.
Yeah.
You can't play the music you want. You've got to stick to the same playlist, which goes around every 2 hours.
Because
someone said that, everyone believes it.
It's boring. It's so boring and bland. It really is. But you carry on doing what you're doing, and I will just see what happens, mate.
While I'm on the phone, I must say I'm quite disappointed with your studio.
Oh, what's wrong now?
What's
wrong? What's wrong?
Well, I thought at Chris Reardon Towers it was some huge palatial double bedroom, not some sort of converted broom cupboard.
Converted? What do you mean converted broom cupboard? Broom cupboard, dear? What do you mean?
I mean, let's face it, if that was a bedroom, if you come in the door there where the light switch is and turn the light switch off, the light would still be on by the time you got to the bed, wouldn't it?
There's nothing wrong with this. This is just one studio, dear. I've got tens of hundreds of studios here. This is a complex, the United Kingdom Talk Television Complex, if you don't mind.
Is that the Saturday room, the Saturday studio?
The what? Yeah, there's a different room for every day. Thank you very much.
I do beg your pardon. I'll take it back.
Thank you, Vectis. Nice to talk to you.
Yeah, and you have a great weekend.
Yeah,
Chris.
Good luck to you. Chin up, chin up. I can hear you a bit disappointed, so chin up. Carry on and see how it goes. Don't go yet.
No, I'm sure it'll be all right. We'll stick with it.
What you mean. Cheerio now. Toodle pip. That's an old fashioned saying. It. Toodle pip. Toodle pip. Let's do some of your messages coming in here. Alan says nutty is a fruitcake, but he's lovely. Thank you very much. That's me. Yes. John Mercer. Hello, John. Up at Tameside there, said next Doctor Who should be Joanna Lumley. Yes. And what an excellent choice that would be, Joanna Lumley. I don't know if I get the feeling she wouldn't. I don't know if she would want that job, actually. Joanna Lumley. Excellent choice. Thank you, John. Alan says Richard O'Brien. No. No, I don't think Richard O'Brien. You've all got your choices, though, so you carry on there. Hang on a minute. What's going on here? I thought that this has kind of gone the wrong thing. My messages seem to have gone the wrong way somehow. What have I done here? I've done something wrong now. Just a minute. Let's go back. Shall I go forwards or backwards? Sorry, gang. Let me just try and go backwards there. That might work now. There's Sarita, Ben, Adam Green, Sarita, James Dean. Good morning to James Dean, who's on his way into the office. James works at Tameside Radio. Good afternoon, James. Paul says, I think the background is neutral. Very good on the eyes. Yeah, it was a little bit too much, the last. I liked it, but it just would not work with the new camera. There was so much going on behind us there. Thank you. Sarita says, I'm so sad I don't have BBC, so I can't watch the new episodes. But you must get those in the States. Don't you get the Doctor Who in the States? You must get them on there sometime. Broadchurch, by the way, is a TV series on ITV, okay? And David Tennant, which is one of the older Doctor Who's. I think he was two Doctor Who's ago, wasn't he? Not this one, not that one, but the one before. So, he was in that. Good morning to Ronnie. My best mate Ronnie is in New York at the moment on a bus. Ding, ding. He's on the bus somewhere, but he's probably gone by now. James says, Chris Marshall, Death in Paradise. Thank you, James. Yeah, that's the man we're thinking about. I quite like him to be Doctor Who. Paul says, I remember when I was six, hiding from the opening part of Doctor Who. What, the bit with the beginning? When it's all coming towards you, isn't it? It's very good now. I must say, very, very good now, the way that looks. Sarita says, is the Dalek still behind you? No, it's over there at the moment. I've put it over there because, unfortunately, the battery acid had started leaking out underneath and it had all gone blue. So a little bit dodgy. I didn't want to leave it on there. So that's what's happened there, Sarita. Paul says, in your opinion, who was the best Doctor Who, John Pertwee or Tom Baker? I'm having difficulty choosing between the two. Either John Pertwee or Tom Baker. Excellent Doctor Who's. Tom Baker's still, of course, with us. John Pertwee died quite a couple of decades ago now, I think it was. Alan says he thinks Tom Baker was the best one. So does Paul. Paul thinks Tom Baker was the best one. Paul says the guy from Crystal Maze would make a good Doctor Who. No, I don't think so. Richard O'Brien, that is. I wouldn't like to see him as Doctor Who, I don't think. Not for me, anyway. Ray Reynolds says, Nick and I met Colin Baker at the Shaw Theatre about 20 years ago when he starred in Privates on Parade. He was charming and interesting to talk to. Yeah, I should think he would be. Yeah. Of course, he made an appearance at the end of a couple of years ago at one of the Doctor Who's, wouldn't it? When he changed from one to the other. Anyone else want to call in about Doctor Who, or we can move on this afternoon? My phone-in number up there on the television there, OK? 020-8144-3477. 020-8144-3477. Sarita's saying I could be the next Doctor Who as well. Well, no, because I haven't got I'd need an equity badge or something like that, whatever it's called. All right, we'll move on. A packed night last night at the karaoke for St. Patrick's Night, boys and girls. That was at Central Station. We had a really good night last night. Really, really good. Except I was late. And I left, as always, in plenty of time. And the clock was telling me I would be there in 1 hour and 30 minutes, 2 hours and 20 minutes. I was queuing. And the annoying thing is, okay, the really annoying thing is, if I'd have probably got near that queue 2 minutes later, it would have seen it. But my sat-nav tells me where the traffic was. But the accident must have just happened a couple of minutes with me away from this particular point. So there's this road that comes in, the West Way, which becomes Euston Road. And you kind of go up and down and up. It's like it's almost like a motorway. It was supposed to become a motorway years ago, but they run out of money. So instead of going right across and having all these different ones coming off it, it comes down at near Baker Street Station. And I started queuing there, and it said 6 minute delay. I thought, oh, well, that's not too bad. And then it went 10 minute delay, and then it went 15 minute delay. And at this point, it's too late for me to do anything. I couldn't divert. The sat nav couldn't tell me to divert because it was already on it and there was no more exits. And so I got stuck on there. And the most ridiculous thing, what it was, eventually I got to the problem. It took about, I think I was in this traffic about 35 minutes in the end. And I got to see, and I could see indicators. And now I could see blue flashing lights. I thought, okay, it's an accident. And what it was a broken down white van in the middle lane. But a police car had come along and parked itself diagonally across two lanes, the inside one and the middle one. So everything was being shunted over onto the right-hand lane. And I looked and I didn't see, I mean, I suppose there could have been some sort of serious accident. But by the look of it, there wasn't another car or someone underneath the van or a bike or anything like that. So it just looked to me like a broken down van. And I couldn't understand, why didn't they just move the blooming van? You know, I'm sure there's other countries, perhaps China. I've got a feeling it's China, where if there is an accident, they just get this bulldozer thing and push the damn thing out of the way. I mean, it was so stupid. I mean, of course, I don't know all the facts. Maybe someone did get hurt or injured and they need it as like a crime scene or someone came out with a gun. I don't know. But there it was, stuck in the middle lane, hazard lights on. And I couldn't see any damage to the van itself other than a little bit on the front, which could have been there before. I couldn't understand why didn't they just move it over to the other side of the road so we can get past. So I didn't go in. I like to be, on a Friday night, I like to be at work by 7:45 to start at 8:30. I can actually set up in 15 minutes, easy, 15 minutes. But I like an extra half an hour just in case things go wrong. You know, if you book me to do something, I'm generally there at the crack of dawn, ready to start. Because I like to be all set up and ready. And of course, I walked in 29 minutes past 8, and oh God. And I hate being, I'm supposed to start at 8:30. I really hate being late. I hate it so much. And it didn't happen last night, but some people think it's quite funny to say, oh, you're a bit late. Like, I don't know that already. But they didn't do that last night, fortunately. I might have bitten their head off if they'd have done that, but they didn't. So I set up as quickly as possible. I got a round of applause as I came in. And of course, it was already very busy, ready for St. Patrick's night. And all the regulars were there. Ray Reynolds was there. Maureen was there. Steve was there. Non-Irish Mary from Ireland was there. Everyone was there. Roy was there. And they were all ready to start. Anyway, I set up as quickly as possible and off we went. And it turned into an extremely good night. Of course, once again, at the end, at 10 minutes before we're due to finish, this girl come up. Oh, can we sing? I said, I'm afraid you're too late. But it's his birthday. Well, I'm sorry, it's too late. On and on and on. They don't get it, do they? You know, we started at 8:30. There's been people sitting there since 8:00. I'm not going to put you in on, you know, it's unfair. And they go on and on and on. And you know, the only way to do it is to keep smiling and say, I'm sorry, we're full up, which we are. We're full up. We can't squeeze anyone else in, not without taking someone else out. It's not just not possible. And they, you know, and I sometimes I pick up the mic and say, please don't. It's not my fault. This isn't the big bad guy not letting you sing. We have no more room. End of story. And that's how it is. So an excellent night last night. The trip home wasn't too bad. there was a road going three lanes to one again because they're doing some roadworks. But my sat nav picked that up straight away and sent me left so I could go down the back roads and come out again at the other end. It's wonderful. You must get a, if you do a lot of driving in London, you need a sat nav that tells you the traffic. I highly recommend TomTom with the live traffic updates. It's really good, really good. I've had that for a few years. It was actually my best mate Ron that bought me the TomTom app a number of years ago now. I think I've had it about 3 years now, the TomTom app. I'm sure I have. And it's really good. You know, it does the job, gets you around the traffic most of the time. Unless, of course, you've hit it really late. So that's the way it goes, OK? All right, boys and girls. I think we'll wrap up now, OK? Let me do today's birthdays. Happy birthday today to Alessandro. DJ Alessandro is very, very popular on the London house scene. Happy birthday to you, Alessandro. Happy birthday today to Gillian, Patsy, Zarifis. I think it's Zarifis. All right, happy birthday. Gary Clifford is 49 today. You don't look 49, Gary, I must say. Happy birthday to you, sir. Yannick Clay. I haven't seen you for ages, Yannick. He used to ring in all the time. Or he used to email the show all the time. 25 years old today. Happy birthday to you, Yannick. I hope you're doing very well. What are you doing in your life? What are you doing, working as? Come back to me because I'd like to know. I'll keep an eye on people, all right? Michael Conran is 60 years old today. Happy birthday, Michael. Stacey Kelly. All right, Stacey. Oh, my lovely golden lion girl. Where are you? Hope you and your man's okay. Happy birthday, Stacey. Joannes Prince. Happy birthday, Julia Londoner, 25 years old today. And Nigel Cullen. Hello, Nigel. All right, sir. Happy birthday to Nigel as well. Let's sing you the song, boys and girls, and then it's going to be time for my dinner, I think. Yes. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday, happy birthday to you. Okay? Enjoy your birthdays, boys and girls, on this Saturday night. I'll be doing a little bit of DJing tonight, again, at Central Station. It's my usual Saturday night haunt now. We've got some cabaret with Topping and Butch. That's on stage at 10:30. I start at 9:30 tonight doing some DJing at Central Station. Just a couple of little messages coming in late there. Rachel said, at least you look normal now. You changed the backing. I don't think I could ever look normal, Rachel, to be honest. And Alan says, I used to be in the bill a few years ago, and I think Eric Richard, who played Sergeant Cryer, would make a good Doctor Who as well. So there we are. That's our little Doctor Who chat. Well, I never intended to do Doctor Who. And, of course, I've got all this stuff here. I've got all this stuff here that I haven't used. Maybe another show tomorrow. Have a lovely Saturday, and I'll see you again very soon. Thanks for watching and listening. Cheerio now. Bye-bye.